Sanjeevi sir, can you hear me, sir? Sir, you are mute, sir.
Okay, just good morning. I just want to know, I have a problem with my Bluetooth. Please hold on a second. I will come back.
Join. It's already full. The capacity planet is full here. So
Soumya, remove some participants immediately.
Yes, sir, I'm doing that.
So, director sir is joining now shortly.
Yes, sir. Yes, Pavan, thank you.
Good morning, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, Sanjeevi Kumar Padmanabhan sir is also arrived, sir.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Yeah, yeah. Good morning. Welcome. Yeah, good morning.
Thank you.
Okay, we can Hari Priya, we can start with the proceedings.
Yeah,
okay,
sure.
Sir. Okay, sir. Ronak? Hello, Ronak?
Yes, ma'am.
Shall we start?
Yes,
okay,
ma'am.
Please start it, Ronak.
A very warm greetings to each and every one of you present here. I hope you all are doing great. I am Ronak Bhatia, your host for today's event. I am extremely overwhelmed to get this opportunity to address you all on this inaugural ceremony of our Institute Lecturer Series. We are very fortunate that Electrical Engineering Department has got the opportunity to organize the inaugural lecture of this initiative. I gladly welcome Dr. Sanjeevi Kumar Padmanabhan, who have graced us by being the respected guest of honor for this event. I would like to welcome the chief guest of today's event, Dr. A.M. Ravani, Director of NIT Raipur. Also, I welcome respected Head of Department, Electrical Engineering, Dr. Narendra Londe, faculty members, and all the students present in this very event. Before starting anything, be it an event or a regular day, we pray Almighty for His blessings. So let's start this event by praising God. Today, that is 18th of September 2021, NIT Raipur is beginning its monthly Institute Lecture Series. In this series, any current technical topic by a national or international eminent personality will be organized in online mode by an academic department every month. This was just a short intro about this initiative. Further, I would request our head of department, Dr. Narendra Londe, to throw some light on the objective of this initiative. Sir, please.
Thank you, Ronak. On behalf of the lettering department, with a great honor, I welcome Chief Guest, Honorable Director Sir, Professor A.M. Ramani, Guest of Honor, Dr. Sanjeev Kumar Padmanabhan Sir of Aarhus University, Denmark, in the inaugural function of the Institute Lecture Series of NIT Raipur. I also welcome our respected deans, head of departments and faculty members of NIT Raipur and our beloved students of NIT Raipur. NIT Raipur is growing by leaps and bounds under the esteemed leadership of our Honorable Director Sir. Since he joined as Director of NIT Raipur, he has taken various initiatives looking into the need of time to benefit students and faculty members of the Institute. On last Independence Day, Sir has announced a monthly Institute lecture series in which every department has been directed to conduct a lecture on relevant and buzzing technical topic by an eminent national and international personality. The objective of this Institute lecture series is to provide an opportunity to the students and the faculty of the Institute to gain awareness and knowledge on the current technical topics directly through the experienced eminent personalities. I sincerely congratulate Director Sir for this initiative. I have a strong feeling that from this kind of lecture series, faculty members and students can upgrade themselves and can receive new motivations and directions to apply technology for socioeconomic developments. I also thank him for giving an honor to Electrical Engineering Department to organize the very first lecture of this series. I also like to thank Dr. Sanjeev Kumar Padmanabhan Sir for accepting our invitation, for gracing this occasion and to deliver the inaugural lecture of this series. Once again, I welcome everyone and request to get benefited from today's lecture. Thank you so much. Over to Ronak.
Thank you, sir, for highlighting the main points of this initiative. Now, I would like to invite Dr. V. Haripriya, the faculty in charge of Electrical Engineering Association, to introduce our guest of honor. Ma'am, please.
Thank you, Ronak, for the kind note. Respected dignitaries of today's inaugural session, heads of various departments, deans, guest of honor, Professor Sanjeevini Kumar Padmanabhan, chief guest of today's session, our honorable director, sir, faculty members, and dear students. A warm welcome to one and all. Myself, Dr. Haripriya Vemuganti, assistant professor, Department of Electrical Engineering. I feel greatly delighted to present the profile of today's guest of honor, Dr. Sanjeevini Kumar Padmanabhan. Originating from the southern part of India, Dr. Sanjeevini Kumar pursued his BE in Electrical and Electronics Engineering from Madras University 2002 and M.Tech in Electrical Drives and Control from Pondicherry University in 2006. He was awarded doctorate from the University of Bologna, Italy in 2011. His research is recognized and funded by both MIUR, Ministry of University Research, Government of Italy, and Department of Electrical Engineering, University of Bologna. After his PhD, he has continued his research as a postdoctoral student at the University of Bologna from 2011 to 2012. As an academician, researcher, senior consultant, and project manager, he rendered his services to various organizations at national and global level, including VIT Chennai, NIT Pondicherry, EduTech LLC, Dubai, Qatar University Doha, Dublin Institute of Technology Dublin, Ireland, University of Johannesburg, South Africa, and Aalborg University, Denmark. Since March 2021, he has been a professor with CTIF, Global Capsule Laboratory, Department of Business Development and Technology, Aarhus University, Denmark. On broad, his areas of research include power converters, control of electric drives, energy storage, renewable energy, microgrids, etc. However, at micro level, his research explored various diversified areas such as energy trading markets, grid-connected converters, power quality of utility, protection of utility grid, multi-phase, multi-level converters, sensorless drive control, dynamic performance and assessment of PV, blockchains, DG, smart electric powertrains, isolated, non-isolated and bidirectional power converters, optimal economic loading, constant power loads, and so on. His research works are published in more than 300 plus research articles in various reputed and high impact journals and received nearly 7,000 plus citations. Dr. Sanjeevini Kumar is a senior member of IEEE, fellow IETE, and a member of nearly 50 plus recognized professional bodies at global level. As a subject expert and editorial board member, associate editor, he contributed his services to various reputed journals such as IEEE Transactions on Industrial Applications, IEEE Systems Journal, IEEE Access, IET Power Electronics, IET Electronics Journal, Wiley International Transactions on Electrical Energy Systems, IET Renewable Power Generation. In recognition to his outstanding professional contribution and accomplishments in the field of engineering, he received many prestigious awards at global level. One of such being the Lifetime Achiever Award given by Marcus Who's Who USA in 2016. For the year 2021, his autobiography was listed as one among the top 2000 most influential and eminent researchers at global level. His consistent dedication, strong passion towards research is a strong motivation and inspirational factor for many young researchers who are willing to make their mark. Thank you, sir, for accepting our invitation and gracing the occasion in spite of your busy schedule. We feel extremely privileged and fortunate to have you as our guest of honor to our inaugural lecture. I strongly believe that next few years are going to be the most impactful years in the life of each and every one of us who are willing to enhance their research exposure. Finally, I'd like to take an opportunity to thank our beloved head of the Department Electrical Engineering and Honorable Director, sir, for their initiatives and consistent efforts to make this event possible. I also thank the students of EEA for making all the possible arrangements for the smooth conduction of the event. Signing off, over to Ronak.
Thank you, ma'am, for the introduction of our guests. I reverently invite Dr. Sanjeevi Kumar Padmanabhan to guide us all with his zestful words. Sir, please.
First of all, I'd like to thank the colleagues from National Institute of Technology and Honorable Director, Head of the Department, my colleagues like Professor Sachin Jain, Professor Anabika, been a good touch for a long period. It's a great opportunity to look at all of you, and especially thanks to all the initiatives done by the Head of the Department, Professor Narendra. It's a great honor today to be with you all, and it's a great initiative by the director and the Department of Electrical Electronics Engineering. So I can see now the institutions from Government of India, especially NITs, are focusing more on research, which is a great sign, and of course a great blessing from the director. In this case, we are very open, and of course I can say something which is very important. These lecture series utilize this opportunity to get connected with various collaborators away from India. Of course, most important is the connection within India, and of course parallel it should be from foreign countries, because in this way the exchange of students programs for bachelor, masters, or inspirational DST programs for faculty visit to the abroad through the director's referral can be easily initiated, and for the prospective development of National Institute of Technology Raipur in four coming years. It's going to be a big opportunity when such programs are initiated in a regular manner. I'm very happy that this program is organized like every month, which is going definitely a challenge for the department and for the director to find various resource persons, but still it's a great initiative. Of course, there's a great opportunity to interact with different minds from different societies. In this way, the students can get benefited. Of course, they can find their future opportunities for PhD programs or master programs. You can travel abroad and exploit your knowledge. Apart from Government of India, from DSD, SERP fundings are really available to pursue a part of your PhD program in abroad, like United States or US, Australia or New Zealand, where you can go for 1 or 2 years. And I think if I'm right, Government of India is paying $2,000 per month. So you can utilize this opportunity by doing your PhD from NIT, Raipur, and travel abroad for a period like 1 or 2 years. Of course, from SERB, there is another funding for postdoctoral researchers. And of course, this I think it's like $3,000 they are paying, if I'm right, need to verify. And it is also for 1 or 2 years. So there are great opportunities open through the director of the institution, and utilize this opportunity to be collaborated with industries, of course, most important, because now Government of India is focused more on CO2 emission. In this case, we are going to have the future more on energy storage, electric vehicle technologies, and hydrogen power generation. So these are the areas which I believe the young generation, I mean, from NIT or Raipur, should focus more developing the technologies and inbuilt hardware developments, so that it can be a good collaboration between industries and NIT Raipur. And as I said, it's a great moment, and I wish you all the members of the Department of Electrical Electronics Engineering, especially also to the Honorable Director, for inviting me to this event. I wish you all great success. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for letting us know about so many opportunities for Indian students abroad. We are very fortunate that we got a chance to hear from you. Now I would like to request our Honorable Director, sir, Dr. A.M. Ravani, to bless us with his words of wisdom. Sir, please.
Yeah, very good morning. I believe that I'm audible. Dr. Londe, yes, I'm audible.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Oh, okay. Yeah, Professor Sanjeev Kumar, Dr. Londe, head of the department, electrical engineering, deans of the institute and faculty members and students. It's really a pleasure for me that we have started with this series of lectures, that is the institute lecture series. And today we are having the beginning of that, and that too from the electrical engineering department. The very purpose of giving this particular lecture series to electrical engineering department to start with, for that, the reason is that the electrical engineering department is the best department. We have started with the awarding the best department since last 2 years, and the department is winning continuously for the 2 years. And I thought that this is the best time when the department should be given the opportunity to start with this lecture series. And that's why the first lecture was given to the electrical engineering department. Actually, as the faculty members of the institute might be aware, that we have started this lecture series where every month we have the lectures by the experts, renowned experts of the globe, from anywhere in the world. And one department will arrange on a particular month, and next month another department will arrange, and like that it will continue, so that every month we have opportunity to listen to expert in a particular area. The purpose of starting this lecture series is no doubt well known, but there are certain hidden benefits of that as well, which I think some of you may not be understanding. That's why I think it's better that my idea behind this, I should tell you that why we have started this particular lecture series. See what happens when we arrange any kind of program, any kind of you can say interaction. So there we meet some of the, you can say, experts in the program, we interact with them. So we get an idea of the whatever the research is going on in the particular field, and what are the possibilities of further research and all. That is always there. But in this particular lecture series here, the lectures will be arranged not necessarily on the topic which are covered under the undergraduate or postgraduate program of the institute, but it may be any topic of interest related to, you can say, engineering discipline. So, and in this particular lecture series, the, not only faculty members, but the students of not of that particular department, but all of the whole institute are invited to participate in that. So everybody is getting an opportunity to listen to the, you can say, experts. So for example, today the professor from the electrical is available with us as an expert. And here the faculty members and students might be from other departments. They have opportunity to listen to him and can explore the area of the multidisciplinary research. If you look at the NEP 2020, National Education Policy 2020, it focuses more on the multidisciplinary kind of education and research. So we want to develop that kind of culture in the institute, because today we cannot think of the technology of a particular discipline, because all technologies are converging and meeting, mixing together. So there is nothing like that, a B.Tech in electrical engineering, I should say. He should know many more things beyond electrical. So we have to understand that particular philosophy. And with that thinking, these kind of lecture series are started. And I advise the all other departments as well that whenever they arrange these kind of series in the future, these kind of lectures in the future, they should always motivate, not only invite it, but motivate the faculty members of all departments and students, such scholars of all departments, to participate in such kind of things, such kind of lectures. Here, we are getting opportunity to explore the area of the research, and one can carry out, continue the research in that area. So here, the one thing is that we understand that what are the possible areas of the research. We understand that what is going on at the world level. And secondly, it is also providing an opportunity of networking and you can say collaboration, because an educational institute cannot work in isolation. That we have to understand very well. Many times it is said that the educational institutes are not collaborating very well with the industries. But I should say that the collaboration with the industries is not only essential, but we have to collaborate equally with the other educational institutes as well. So the experts, those who are coming to us and delivering the lectures, they might be from the other educational institutes, renowned educational institutes. So we are getting opportunity to you can say develop a relationship with them and think of having a collaboration with that particular institute. One thing more I would like to make it clear here for the, you can say, the future lectures as well. That is not necessary that you always invite the expert from the, you can say, education institutes. The experts might be from any research institutes as well. Basically, we want to understand the current trend in the particular technology, current trend of the research, and want to explore the area of the possible areas of the research and collaboration. So with that thing, it started. One more thing that I observed, that in many of the institute, the lecture series is already existing, and they are the usually before COVID, they used to have the lecture series in physical mode, where the expert come a long way from one corner, any corner of the country, and they deliver the lecture, and a lot of, you can say, cost and time is also involved there. But due to COVID, we are now habituated with this online mode of delivery of lecture and all. So there is no boundary of the country. We can have the experts from anywhere in the globe. So I think all of us should understand and use this as an opportunity. This is an opportunity where somebody, say, for example, today we have the Professor Sanjeev Kumar, he is from Denmark, sitting in Denmark and delivering lecture. Otherwise, we would have invited him. It's difficult for him to come over to India for simply delivering a lecture for 1 hour or 2 hours, because everybody is busy in their routine and their own commitments and all. So this particular, you can say, the COVID scenario has taught us that we have these kind of opportunities, and all of us should encash that opportunity. So I suggest and I advise the head of departments of all other departments, those who are going to arrange the lecture series in the future, they should try to have the experts from across the globe so that we have an exposure that what are the, you can say, good things which are going on in that institute, what are the cutting edge technologies in which they are conducting research, so we can we also proceed in that direction. So without wasting much of the time, I think it's time where we would like to listen to Professor Sanjeev Kumar. And before I end, I would like to congratulate the department for arranging this program. And I also would like to thank Dr. Sanjeev Kumar for accepting our invitation. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for starting this initiative. It will definitely help students in overall development. Once again, thank you for your enlightening words. Now, I would like to invite Dr. Venu Sonti, faculty in charge of Electrical Engineering Association, to present vote of thanks for this inaugural ceremony.
Thank you, Ronak. A very good morning to all. On behalf of Electrical Engineering Department, NIT Raipur, it's my honor and privilege to propose vote of thanks to one and all present here today. First and foremost, I would like to thank our chief guest, Honorable Director Sir, for sparing his valuable time to grace this inaugural ceremony. I would also like to thank our Honorable Director Sir for initiating the innovative programs like Institute Lecture Series, where the students and faculty members can get knowledge and awareness about the current technical topics from the expert lectures by the eminent personalities over the globe. Next, I would like to thank our guest of honor, Professor Dr. Sanjeev Kumar Padmanabhan Sir, for sparing his valuable time in attending this inaugural ceremony. I would also like to thank Sir for accepting our invitation to deliver an expert lecture in our prestigious Institute Lecture Series program. I would also like to thank our deans and head of the institutes for attending this inaugural ceremony. My heartfelt thanks to the head of the department, Dr. Narendra Londe Sir, for his guidance, support, and encouragement in all our efforts. I would also like to thank the faculty members for their guidance and support in conducting this event. Next, I would like to thank the student coordinators for their continuous efforts in making this inaugural ceremony a grand success. Once again, thank you all for your attention. Thank you. Over to you, Ronak.
Thanks a lot, sir, for expressing gratitude. So it's now time for the lecture. Without any further ado, I'll now hand over the stage to our guest to begin with his session. Sir, please.
Thank you very much to the director and head of the department. Of course, the student who has given a brief introduction about the session. Thank you. Let me start my presentation. Could you please confirm my audio is visible? My audio and video is okay with you, because I don't know what is going on another side. So could you please confirm? Yeah, thank you.
It's audible, sir.
Thank you very much. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Could you confirm my video is visible on another side? On your side?
Yes, sir. It's visible, and okay. The presentation mode is also.
Perfect. My slides?
Yes, sir.
Today, I like to present something which we've been working for the past 8 years with along the research group members and the researchers, various postdoctoral researchers and PhD students and some master students. So this topic is more, I give you a broad classification on generally how we are working with our own indigenous developments, means from the scratch, and what the concepts we have developed, because this can be very useful for masters and PhD students, or what are the backgrounds we have been developed. So in 2017, we done one of the finest article in my career focused on EV technologies and power converters and electrical emissions, which received more than 500 citations. And this is a source which we started knowing more about electric vehicle technology, how could be the future. We proposed in 2017, but today the world everywhere moving finally towards the same technology of fuel cell and renewable energy. So my talks, how this is going to be happen in the future. So As we know, electric vehicles become a common scenario for all the global parts of the world because in order to compensate or minimize the CO2 emission, in Europe, 2030, it should be a 100% electric vehicle. And 2035 is for completely empowering all the transportation by electric vehicle technologies. This is a goal. And 2050 is going to be 100% free of emissions. So on these goals, many research institutions in Europe, of course, in the United States, they start working more. In India, yes, we have started already for converting the two-wheelers and three-wheelers market into electric vehicle based on battery technologies. So in this case, that is a big picture. We are going to see what are the basics of electric vehicle, because it's maybe for a bachelor students be a new topic, how we are going to use these batteries and electric machines, and what are the impacts and techniques we are using for charging. Today, if you look at the market is dominated by Nissan, Chevrolet, and Tesla. They manufacture a large-scale electric vehicles. Apart from that, there is a good competitor from Asia, which is a Chinese market, which is from the company called BYD. So obviously, the Chinese market produces all the electrical vehicles at a cheaper cost. Obviously, it's a big challenge for other companies, includes India, to compete with them. So in this case, we need to find a solution which is a cheaper price and, of course, a comfortable, required, luxurious need for the consumers. So if you look at electric vehicles, how we got this terminology? So it is from International Electrotechnical Commission, Technical Committee 69, which decides the electric road vehicles proposed from United States, and how we call the terminology of electric vehicles in different types based on the categories of energy storage and converters. We classify all the vehicles into different combinations. So the combination can be an IC engine, which is a conventional combustion engine, which has a petrol and diesel as a prior powertrain unit, which covers the complete electric with the vehicles with a battery. So one option. Second option, we can go for battery and flywheel, battery and capacitors, battery and fuel cell, which is going to be the future of all the electric vehicles. Apart from that, you can also have ultra capacitors, can be a compensation for the battery. So these are the different combination where we can have different hybrid model of electric vehicles. From this combination, we categorized and given the terminologies for different electric vehicle. First one is the battery-based electric vehicle, which is now going on in India for two-wheelers and three-wheelers. Hybrid electric vehicles. Then we have a plug-in hybrid electric vehicle, which is a big market in US and Europe. We are having more focused on these areas. Of course, in the future, it's going to be a fuel cell-based electric vehicle. Why? Because a complete battery-based electric vehicles cannot give the maximum power or a large power capacity for a transportation. For example, in case of marine transportation for a ship or cruise, we can't use batteries. It's not sufficient. Of course, for airways, it's not possible. So in this case, the alternative solution definitely for the production of high power train is going to be the fuel cell. But the major problem will be the cost. I will show you on the later slides. Recently, in government of India also initiated an agreement with Japan and United States to start fuel cell based train network in India. The agreement is already done. So you can see the influence, how this fuel cell is going to be play a critical role in the future market in all parts of the country. About a battery based electric vehicle, how it looks. So it can have a battery bank of lithium battery, which is connected to an inverter, which converts the DC power to the AC, and it is coupled to a motor. It can be a induction motor or a synchronous motor or any special purpose motor, depends on the luxurious need of the consumer. Then the shaft is connected to the differential wheel, far end, and of course the rear end side, so you produce a mechanical motion. So this is standard model how an electric vehicle looks. In case of a battery-based electric vehicles, we can cover a distance between 100 kilometers to 250 kilometers. At a top range, we can go up to 500 kilometers, but it depends on the country, road infrastructure, and traffic condition. For example, in case of Mumbai, Chennai, or Delhi, which is highly thickly populated and roadways have a lot of always traffic jams. In this case, it's going to be less because we are going to have a frequent stop and stop, braking, etc., so that we can't predict, we can able to have the able to achieve the kilometers. The most important challenge will be how to have a frequent charging station, and a battery charging station requires the energy from the grid or It can be done from the local power available as a, we call it as a technically microgrids. So we can have a grid connected microgrids or standalone microgrids. Standalone microgrid is better because we are not going to pollute the grid. So as we increase integrating number of collectronic circuits, renewable energy system integrated with the grid, obviously we power more pollution. Pollution means harmonic components, voltage instability, and voltage sag and swell to the grid. So that is a big phenomenon needed to be controlled. So in this case, most prominent solution is going to be isolated or islanded mode microgrids, because we can use the local energy and we can have the charging station. These type of electric vehicles are much used for a low or medium speed application with a minimum torque demand. So the market is available from Nissan, Tesla, which is predominantly selling large scale battery based electric vehicles, along with the Chinese company BYD. About hybrid electric vehicle, what is a hybrid electric vehicle? Hybrid electric vehicle has a conventional IC engines along with electrical networks. So it's going to have both batteries and electric IC in conventional petrol engine. So it's not going to be a pure or I say doesn't going to have 100% emission free, because still we have the IC engine. But the technology is used because suddenly all the vehicles cannot be converted into electric. It needs a step. So if you look at the operating modes in starting condition, the motor is going to be started. And as we know the basics of electrical engineering, from the rotation of the shaft, we can be able to get the power from the motor also. The power can be fed to the battery and we can store the energy. One possibility. In stop condition, we can't be able to charge from the motor because it's in a standstill position. The battery can be charged only from the available single phase grid available in the home. So it can be charged in the night times. Then it is called a plug-in based electric vehicle. So we need to plug the batteries to charge in the night during the rest time. Other possibilities, we have three mode of operation: passing, braking, and cruising. During the passing, we can be able to pump the power available in the battery to the motor. Of course, we can use the main powertrain IC engine. So here the powertrain is a combination of IC engine and batteries. Other possibility is the braking. We know what is a braking. If you apply a brake for an electric motor, you generate regenerative power. So regenerative powers can be delivered back to the battery and we can store it. So another methods by which we can able to optimize the battery for charging. Other possibility is the cruising, because under running condition, the motor is going to be continuously rotated. If IC engine is sufficient enough to drive the complete power unit, then we can power the battery simultaneously. And there is a shortage from IC engine. I mean, if there is a shortage from petrol or diesel, can balance the power from the battery. What is the complexity in this network? We have a mechanical network. We have an electrical network. Obviously, the algorithms which we develop to control both mechanical and electrical is always a challenging task for an engineer to balance the power flow. When it is a pure electrical, it is more easy to control with the DSP. When there is a mechanical part needed to be controlled along with the electrical network, is always a challenge and it's expensive. As I said, the most focused area is now in Europe is plug-in electric vehicles. So in plug-in electric vehicle, the concept is the same. We are going to have an IC engine and the battery. But the difference is the capacity of the battery needed to be equivalent to the IC engine. This may increase the price of the complete electric vehicles. So in this case, if you look at the operation, the electric mode is done by completely by the IC engine is used to boost or charge up the battery banks. And the batteries are used only at a low charging rates. So in this way, we can try to reduce the cost a little bit, but still it is expensive. Only as I said, the reason is the capacity of the battery needed to be equivalent to the IC engine. And these modules are much sold out by Chevrolet, and Toyota is a more popular company. The future, as I said, it's going to be fuel cell based electric vehicles. So I don't want to go inside much with how the hydrogen power generation or what is a fuel cell. The basic is we need to have hydrogen stations instead of petrol pump or diesel pump. Then inside the electric vehicle, the onboard cylinder will be available to store the hydrogen. Through fuel cell, we convert all these liquid hydrogen into DC power. The DC power available from the fuel cell is not sufficient enough to drive the motor. So we use power electronics converter here to control all these operation, includes a powertrain and luxurious needs. So for generation of these power, we need air, because it's going to, the fuel cell works with the air and hydrogen. So air will be taken from the surrounding environment. So the technology is much simpler. What is the major drawback? The drawback is scarcity of hydrogen power generation. how to develop more hydrogen power station where the replacement for the petrol and diesel stations. And the most important is the cost. So the cost is $200 per kilowatt in case of a fuel cell. IC engine is $50 per kilowatt. So you can see the difference where the parameter and technology needed to be. So we need to find a technology which how a hydrogen can be generated or produced at cheaper cost, and how to improve the efficiency of the fuel cell, because the fuel cell has a big margin of deficiency with the efficiency, which is around 60%. And we have to look how to make more hydrogen power stations instead of a pumping station, instead of petrol and diesel. What is the optimal solution we have to look? So these are the parameters, challenges before us in the future. And about the company, commercially it is available from Toyota and Honda City, Clarity. These companies use hybrid model, not only the hydrogen plus a battery bank. This is an example in Finiferina H2 speed supercar used for sports. They use hydrogen fuel technology. That's why the vehicles are running at a very high speed, more than 450 kilometers per hour. So that's you can see from the television with the sports channels. And the plug-in electric vehicles, as you see, during the daytime, the power is run by the fuel cell, and you can able to charge the batteries from the home application with the grid. In the future, it's going to be the power from the battery to the grid, to the main grid, so that all the consumer going to get a benefits from the grid operator. So it's like an economical, techno-economical policy. All the electric vehicle owners going to get some margin for pumping the power to the grid, which is also a predominant application in the entire European state, particularly the Denmark is focusing more on these technologies. In comparison, I can give you a overall idea. So we have a battery-based electric vehicles where we have more driving units or electric motors. Energy storage technologies mostly adapted with the battery and ultra capacitors. Why we use ultra capacitors? Because batteries presently we use only lithium ion, and lithium ion is an expensive battery. And of course, the lifetime is not for 50 years. It's limited to 15 years or 8 years. Recently, it is all the batteries are only designed for 8 years. So we need to have reduce the cost. So the ultra capacitor is an additional solution. We can use parallel operation and compensate the price of the batteries. Advantage, no emission because it's purely electrical and no need of oil. And the battery capacity decides the running condition and speed of the complete electric vehicle. Commercially, it is available, but the problems are the capacity of designing the batteries and the price of the battery, fast charging. At present, as I said, yes, charging time required for a minimum charge is between 30 to 25 minutes in one charging. But if you want to have a complete charging of the electric vehicle, it takes 6 to 7 hours. And availability of or scarcity of having a battery-based electric charging station is another problem. This is a very expensive design. Other part, we have a hybrid electric vehicles. Hybrid electric vehicle is a combination of IC engine and electric motor as a main powertrain. And energy storage we have as like a combination battery, ultra capacitors, and IC engines. In this case, it's not purely CO2 emission free because there is an IC engine still, so we'll have an emission. It has a large power transmission because we use a conventional IC engine, so it can travel for a long distance. Heavy duty vehicles can be applied. And here the complex structure is the problem between, as I said, power balance between batteries and IC engines, and commercially available for the market. And in this case, the major challenge is to have this equal capacity of the battery to the IC engine. So it's a very complex. We have a high power IC engines, and we need to have a battery which is equivalent to that capacity is a big optimization problems and sizing. Fuel cell electric vehicles, I showed here only fuel cell, but the future is going to be a hybrid model because we are going to have a battery also. In this case, it's a purely electric motor and the fuel is going to be fuel cell. So there is no emission, maybe a very little emission because of the hydrogen, which can be neglected. High efficiency as like IC engines, they can have a high power more than that because the best example is them. The rocket propulsion systems, they don't use conventional petrol, they use fuel cell. That's why we are getting so much energy at the time of installation and focusing towards the travel. And it completely depends on hydrogen power, and it's commercially available. The problem again is the cost of the fuel, the generation of hydrogen, shortage of scarcity of hydrogen pump stations, and of course, how to make it a cheaper price is a big challenge. This is an example, another way of developing new technologies in power generation capacities. So in this case, if you look at from the wheels, motor wheels, we can able to get the power by connecting the cables. It's a conventional technology with the grounding effects. So we are connecting the cables and we are connecting the batteries and we are storing the energy is a part. It is a the current scenario. But in the research focused more on wireless technology because we avoid these cables and of course the deterioration of the cables and maybe an accidental cut, etc. So avoid all these difficulty and cost optimization. Other technologies focused on wireless charging network. We have a primary coil on the battery side, secondary coil on the wheel side, and the power transmission is possible. But in this case, the design of these two coils is very complex, and the distance is the criteria to determine the standardization, and the power transfer is limited because of the coil design and the power rating required for the battery. So in this case, we are trying to have a wireless power network, which is developed from Sato and his group. The experimental model they tested in the university and they find its work according to the standard. The big challenge is designing these coils. And in general, how a wireless charging station looks. So we have a power bank. The power bank is connected to a buck boost converter. What is a buck boost converter? We can have a high voltage or low voltage when compared to the input. So it has a two mode of operation, step up or step down. And it is connected to a inverter, which is a high frequency inverter. So it's not a standard inverter. All these DCs will be converted into AC available on the primary winding. And the power stage, you can have a look. It transfers from 3.28 kilowatt to the primary winding around 3.13 kilowatt. So remaining is the losses. And this is the air gap. The power has to be transferred to the secondary winding. On the secondary winding, we are getting 3 kilowatt. So we have the loss like 1.3 kilowatts. And this part is going to be on mounted on the electric vehicle. So this is a charging station. And this is onboard mounting of the electric vehicle. Here we have a secondary inverter converter, which converts all these AC voltage. It's not a conventional AC voltage. It's not look like off cycle between positive or negative. It's a different high frequency signal and it will be converted into DC. And we have a large capacity to control ripple content because it's a standard. We have IEEE standard 519 to control the ripple content. And these power will be delivered to the inverter, which converts the DC voltage to AC to drive the motor. You can see the power available here is 2.19 kilowatt. So actual power capacity is 3.28 kilowatt, but we are delivering to the electric vehicle is only 2.91 kilowatt. So you can have an idea where to improve the complete network. There is a big loss because of the two areas, power generation to the load side. If you look at the efficiency from the source, to the primary winding of the resonant tank circuit is 95.4%. And in the resonant tank, the efficiency is around 96.1%. And the power delivered from the secondary converter to the three-phase inverter is around 96.8%. If you look at the overall efficiency from the source to the load side converter of the electric vehicle, which is around 88.8%. So you have the margin. This is not our goal. As an electric engineers of power electronic technology, we are focusing more near to 97 to 98%. About the batteries, there are a lot of standards from United States. We can't have a battery what we want for an electric vehicle. And these batteries developed by Advanced Battery Consortium from United States. And there are standard guidelines there are some primary goals. If you look at the batteries for their energy density, discharging rates, it should be 135 for midterm and for long term, it is 300. Specific energy, which is desired around the ratio of 100, it should be 80 watt hour per kilogram. And for long term, it should be 200. Power density, which is around 250 for midterm and for long term, it's 600. Specific power, which is calculated watt per kilogram, which is 150 for the midterm and for the long term is 400. Lifetime, which is calculated per year. So it's for the midterm is 5 and long term is 10. Life cycle, which is calculated on 80% of the cycle. So 600 cycles, the charging and discharging for the midterm. For the long term, it is going to be 1,000. And the price should be less than 150 USD per kilowatt hour. And for the long term is less than 100. Operating temperature is very important because different countries have different temperature. And so minus 30 to 65 degree for the midterm. And long term should be minus 40 degrees centigrade to 84 degrees. Recharging is a challenging issue. For midterm, it's less than 6 hours. As I said, we need to go for a fast charging networks, available lithium battery, we can't do it. And for the long term, it's between 3 to 6 hours. Fast recharging, which is calculated on the basis of 40 to 80% of state of the charge of the battery. For midterm, it is 0.25 hours. Secondary goals, self-discharge should be less than 15% of 48 hours. And for the long term, it should be 15% of a month. Efficiency, 75% for the midterm. Long term should be 80%. Maintenance, obviously, battery doesn't require any maintenance. Resistance is very important. They should have a long, high tolerance on different conditions. Thermal losses is already calculated for a battery, which is around 3.2 watts per kilowatt hour for both long-term and mid-term. And we have different battery modules, vehicles based on the technologies. One is IC3, which has a total energy capacity, 22 kilowatt hour, and usable is only 18.8, efficiency 85%. C30 model, we have total energy, 24 kilowatt hour, and usable is 22.7, efficiency 95%. B class, we have total energy 36, usable 28, efficiency 78%. E6 model, total energy capacity available in the electric vehicle is 61.4 kilowatt hour, usable 57, efficiency 93%. RAV4 model, we have the total energy capacity 41.8, and usable is only 35, and the efficiency 84. So if you look at all the models of the electric vehicle, C30 has a very good efficiency, 95%, but the usable is only 22.7. Whereas in C6 model, the total energy capacity usable is 57 kilowatt hour, and the efficiency is 93%. So it's a trade-off between the users, the consumer's application requirements. We can choose the model which is available in the market. I already talked about ultra capacitors. Why I'm talking about ultra capacitors? Because battery banks, lithium batteries are very, very expensive. So part of the power, say like 40% to 50% can be compensated by the ultra capacitors. So ultra capacitors are like a conventional capacitors. They're going to have two electrodes and separated by a medium, which is on a porous electrode. And the principle is the same like a conventional capacitors. In this case, we can able to store large energy when compared to the battery. And we don't want to worry about the state of the charge. It can be powered from an AC grid or a DC grid. We can store the energy from zero charging state to infinity, I mean, to the maximum power rating, and it can be stored for infinite period. The problem associated with that capacitors always, if you are going to have a short spike in a voltage or current, it can be easily damaged. That's why the big challenges in capacitor is to control their reliability and durability is a separate topic of research. So many research is going on with Aalborg University, with Power Electronics Group on these topics, how to have a more reliable capacitors. About a charging station, that's most important scenario. We have two types of chargings, AC charging and DC charging. All these are developed from United States Society of Automotive Engineers. And these standards are given for US standards, but same applicable for India. The only difference is going to be the voltage. So for the level one, it's 120 volt. For level two, it is varying between 208 to 240 volts with three level of variations. Level three go up to 600 volts. Current rating varies from level one, 12 amperes to 16 amperes. Level two, 16 amperes less than or equal to 80. And the last case, level three goes up to 400 amperes. So you can decide what type of power is required. And the branch circuit breakers is very important for the protection, which varies from 15 to 20 amperes for the level one, level two, 20, 40. And the last standard is desired by NEC 635, still the value is not desired. And for the level three is 150 amperes. Output power is very important. These are only designed for a single vehicle's basic requirements. So level one varies from 1.08 to 1.44 kilowatt. For level two, 3.3 to less than or equal to 14.8 kilowatt. And level three is 3 kilowatts. So it's a minimum standard requirement. In the future, we are focusing on DC microgrid-based electric vehicle charging because it doesn't need to be connected with the grid, as I said in the beginning of my slide. So we have three levels, level one, level two, and level three. All the cases, level one and level two varies between 200 to 450 volt, whereas level three goes to 600 volt. Current carrying capacity for the first case is less than or equal to 80, and second case is less than or equal to 200 ampere, and the third case is going to be less than or equal to 400 ampere. And the power, minimum is less than or equal to 36 kilowatt, maximum goes to 240 kilowatt variation for the three levels. How an electric vehicle's inside parameters grid connected system works. So on the left hand side, we have the utility grid. Utility grid will be connected to AC to DC conversion. So AC power will be converted into DC. And we have a common point of coupling, which is a DC high power. The range of this voltage will be around 400 volt to 800 volt requirement. On another side, we have the electric vehicles. One part is devoted for the propulsion of the motors and the driving unit. Another part is for the energy storage. So in the driving unit, we have the motors, which is controlled by the motor drive units along with the converters. The possibility for the acceleration is shown in the green line. The power will be taken from the common point of coupling and given to the motor propulsion system. Of course, from the motor braking and revolution, we can able to generate the power back to the grid through the power electronics converter. On another part, we have the storage technology. During the braking, the power available from the motor will come to the main grid and will be given to the DC-DC converter, and we can store the energy. During the power peak demand from the electric vehicles, we can pump the power from the storage energy capacitors or ultra capacitors or super capacitors, or from the battery bank, we can pump the power through that same DC-DC converter, we can pump to the main grid. So the power balance can be done between the main grid and the storage unit within the electric vehicle. What are the configurations we are having in the power electronics technology? So this is called a universal DC-DC converter. If you look at the closed mode of operation, is a standard buck converter. A standard buck converter always produces a voltage which is less than the input. And we are paralleling two converters. On the load side, we have a boost converter. Again, it is coupled to a buck converter. So we have a multiple stage buck, boost, and buck operation to control the battery units. What is the drawback? In this case, for having the maximum power extracted from the DC source, all these devices cannot able to use the maximum utilization factor or duty cycle or conduction period. That is a drawback. So the efficiency and losses is more in this network. Other possibilities, of course, in India, Professor Gopakumar from IISc Bangalore is working more on these topics. In this case, we are going to have also my area of research on multi-phase drives. In this case, we are going to have an isolated network. So we have a permanent magnet synchronous machine or induction motor where the stator winding doesn't going to have a start point. Instead of having a start point, we are going to have a power on the both side and is pumped from a single battery. In this case, the battery capacity should be 100% and the stresses on the device is reduced because each time the stress on the device is just 50%. The problem in this network is since there is no isolated network and there is a common neutral point, we call it a terminology called homopolar component. Homopolar component doesn't going to have any constant frequency. It's going to have all the frequency like 50 hertz, 10 hertz, 1 hertz, 100 hertz, and it goes to infinity. Because of these small signals generated within the network, the winding can be easily spoiled because it produces a lot of heat, thermal effects, and unbalance in the network. So the propulsion of these motor will have a lot of vibration. To overcome this problem, we can have isolated network. We can have a separate battery and inverter on one side. On another side, we can have a battery and the inverter on a next side of the winding. So there is no any start point. They are isolated. We can compensate the homopolar component. And the battery capacity is going to be only 50%. So here we need 100%. Here it is going to be 50%. What is the drawback? If you lose one inverter or one battery, the power is reduced by 50%. And we need to create a start point on another side, which is a challenging task. But apart from that, even under the faulty condition, this converter provides a most robust solution. That's why it's called a dual inverter-based open winding system. Other possibilities, we have a interleaved boost power factor converter. The difference from the previous topology, we can able to control the power factor on the input side. From the input, we have an uncontrolled bridge rectifier. You know the basics, so it converts the AC into DC, but it's going to be going to have a large AC components, ripple components. Then we use standard boost converter. Two boost converters are cascaded for increasing the current capacity. And we are going to have a load capacitor to reduce the ripple content. What is the drawback of this system? Since this is an uncontrolled bridge rectifier, controlling the power factor on the input side is very difficulty. Of course, we are going to generate a lot of reactive power. And the conduction limitation or utilization of these two devices are limited. We can't use the maximum power. And we need to have a large capacitors. Other possibilities, we can go for a bridgeless dual boost power factor converter. where the configuration is a standard uncontrolled bridge rectifier, but on the lower legs, we put controlled devices, MOSFET or IGBT. So it's become a semi or half cycle, semi-controlled converter. So we can't get the full power from the grid, only half power, because two devices are active devices, we can able to control. Two devices are again uncontrolled devices. And providing a smooth diodes or slow diodes, we can control the current of injection to the grid. So it's a challenging part with the digital processor. Of course, the conduction period is reduced by 50%. We need to have a large capacitor again. This configuration can be further extended by increasing the number of legs. You can have a look here. We are increasing the legs into four. It's like cascading the same network by another configuration. In this case, we can able to pump the power high by the current parameters by reducing the capacitors, but still the problem is the 50% only the duty ratio or conduction period is applicable, and controlling the power factor on the input side is a big complex task. What is the future? The future is focused on resonant converters, which is also called as full bridge converters with zero volt switching and zero current switching. So in this case, we have on the input side, high frequency inverter. On the mid part, we have a resonant circuit or coupled inductor based transformers, where the ratio will be designed between 1:N ratio. On the onboard side of the electric vehicle, we have an uncontrolled bridge rectifier. This is the configuration presently available in all electric vehicles. So we have uncontrolled bridge rectifier, and we can pump the power to the battery. The capacity requirement of the capacity is going to be always large because this is an uncontrolled device. And the ratio of the control of the transformer is limited to 1:N ratio. The same configuration can be extended as a parallel operation. We can cascade in a parallel model, and we can increase the current capacity on the load side uncontrolled bridge rectifier, but still we need to increase the capacitor for balancing, and there will be a large capacitor size is required since this is an uncontrolled bridge uncontrolled bridge converter. But we can able to enhance the current carrying capacity by parallel operation. Other possibilities, if you look at very closely this configuration of the resonant tank circuit, additional capacitor is included, so that we can able to have a different winding configuration, N1:N2. So we can have a different winding terms between the primary winding and secondary winding. We can able to pump the different power to the battery capacity on requirement. The configuration is the same. Only advantage here, we can able to adjust the winding and we can deliver different power. Again, in this case, the capacity is large, and the complexity of transferring the power in the air gap medium is always have a huge loss. We have seen many configuration I have presented here. So we have seen the buck converter, which is operation for step down. And it has a problem with key feature is going to be it can operate in continuous and discontinuous mode. And what is application in electric vehicle? It sends the power to the battery. So it charges the battery. And we have seen buck boost converter. It can use for step up or step down operation and used as like a two core alternator chopper. And this is useful for regenerative braking. When you're applying a braking on the electric vehicles, whenever required, frequent stop, we can pump the power from the motor to the battery. Then we have seen interleaved boost converter. Again, this is a step-up converter. The advantage, we can have a power factor correction. Obviously, there will be a lot of EMI effects. So to compensate this EMI effect, we need a small EMI filter, and it is used for charging. Other configuration, we have seen a dual boost power factor converter. It is also used for step-up. In this case, we doesn't need a rectifier, and it is used for charging. Last configuration, we have seen a resonant converter based capacitor output filter kind of converter, which has a conversion from AC to DC conversion. We convert, then zero switch voltage and zero current switching is required for high power transfer from the source to the load side. And this is also used for charging. So if you want to charge the batteries during the running condition, we have to use buck boost converters. What are the hurdles in electric vehicles? With factors like recharging, yes, recharging is a big challenge for electric vehicles. It depends on the hurdles, how to reduce the weight of the chargers, how to increase the durability, how to reduce the cost. Recycling is going to be the future problem for the engineers, because we are going to have n number of batteries, infinite. Every country going to produce the residue, how to recycle it, and how to size, and how to reduce the charging time is a big challenge on us in the future. Hybrid electric vehicle, what are the hurdles? The battery, durability, weight, and the cost. Hydrogen fuel cell, as I said, hydrogen fuel cell based electric vehicle, the cost of hydrogen is very expensive. So how we can able to reduce the cost, how to make the infrastructure, storage possibilities, durability and reliability, the challenges for hydrogen. And auxiliary power units is also a challenge in electric vehicles. How to reduce the size of the auxiliary power unit, cost, weight, durability, safety is most important in an electric vehicle because batteries are hazardous to damages. And reliability and cooling is very essential, and how to increase the efficiency of the electric vehicle. What are the tentative solution I can give? Because this is our own research we proposed in 2017. Limited range, that's most important. What are the solution? We can have a better energy storage technology. Energy management is required. Long charging period, we have to find a better charging technologies. Safety problems, we need to look for advanced manufacturing schemes and build high quality power converters and controlling units from DSPs. Insufficient charging stations is another problem. So how to make it more placement of sufficient electric vehicles charging station is one of the critical solution we all the researchers are looking how to convert all the pump station, I mean the petrol or diesel pump station, into electric vehicles network. But we need to compensate also the petrol and pump station producers for their marginal benefits and their losses. So it's a big challenge. High price, yes. How to control the high price? Mass production is a simple solution. Countries like India, where we have different economical conditions. Advanced technology is required. Obviously, the government initiative, already the government of India has given the initiatives for EV technologies for 2-wheelers and 3-wheelers for with many concessions. And most important, what will be the storing technology during the braking condition? How we can, because now the fully depends on batteries. What are the other possibilities? We can go for electric storage. We can use same motor and generator. You know, the motor and generator can also generate the voltages and power. It can be stored up to 50%. Recovery is possible. And this is all found in application in battery-based electric vehicles and hybrid electric vehicle. Then we have a technology called compressed gas storage system, which is the most hydraulic motors are used to store the energy. And about 70% of the energy can be recovered. And they are already in application with heavy-duty vehicles. But we are focusing more electric, avoiding mechanical parts because it's going to be complex. So this is an expansive project. Flywheel is another storage technology adapted for electric vehicle. Rotational kinetic, it's just like a motor again, with the rotation of the kinetic energy, we can store around greater than 70%. Formula One racing car use this technology. And gravitational energy storage, which uses a spring storage technology. Still, there is no standardization achieved for recovered power, but already in application with all the trains. What are the challenges for the future? That's going to be the big behind us. So in case of EV scenario, we are going to have major challenges with the three parts. One is going to be, what is the alternative for lithium ion batteries? If there is going to be a battery technology, how we can avoid non-toxic materials, how to increase high power density, reduced cost. Most important, we have to have a lightweight, more capacity and fast charging network. So we need to go for charging schedulings, virtual prototype modules of AI technology, artificial intelligence technology, introducing more smart metering. Smart metering is another applications, works on artificial intelligence technologies. So we need to make more robust power electronics, not an isolated technology away from AI. The future challenge, how to give the power from the vehicle to the grid, how to have a better charging technology, how to have a better charging batteries. Wireless powerless transformation is very important for wireless electric vehicles, charging networks, but it is a very expensive protocol modules and to control the grid. That is a big challenge. With this, I can give you overall scenario why we are looking for fuel cell. This is a broad classification of fuel cell. It has a big family. Why we are choosing fuel cells as an alternative for petrol and diesel? Because if you look at the operating temperature, it varies from minus 20 degrees centigrade to greater than 800 degrees centigrade. Power application less than 50 watts to less than 100 megawatts. It can be applicable for both small or large electric vehicles where the battery cannot work under all these power rating. For example, if I want to use a fuel cell for a small electric vehicle, I can go with Zincar battery. In Zincar battery, we can use the power less than 50 watts and the temperature from 0 to 80 degrees centigrade. For a large vehicle, I can give an example, phosphoric acid fuel cell, where phosphoric fuel cell can be used between 1 to 10 megawatts and the power capacity can be used between 80 to 300 degrees centigrade. So you can see the future, how an hydrogen-based power generation has a large classification from very low power to maximum power. Of course, it can withstand different climatic conditions of the country's requirement. With this application, I can show you how an electric vehicle schematic inside looks. So we have a fuel storage cartridge and then to a fuel reformer, then fuel cell, which converts all these hydrogen into DC power. The power available here is not sufficient enough to drive the motor and its luxurious needs. So the efficiency is reduced to 60%. By using power electronics converters, the initial stage is going to be a DC-DC, which is going to enhance the power available from the fuel cell, then connected to an inverter to drive the motor. Apart from that, we are having luxurious requirement, lights, ACs, production network. All these are also controlled by a DC-DC converter, where power electronics converter give an efficiency around 80%. So you can have an idea how a fuel cell converter based electric vehicle is based working with power electronics converter. This is a hybrid model where we want to reduce the price of the utilization of a fuel cell. We can use batteries and ultra capacitors as a parallel operation. The same technology, so the efficiency is around 60%. We can use DC-DC converter to enhance the power, and we can pump the power to the battery for the storage parallelly with ultra capacitors. And we can drive the motor during the braking condition or running condition. We can get the power through the converter to store the batteries. It's like a bidirectional operation. Under the scarcity condition from the fuel cell, we can use the power from the battery. And of course, for additional requirement of luxurious needs, we need additional power electronics converters, DC-DC, which gives an efficiency around 80%. Large scale transportation is very challenging. Then we need an internal DC microgrids. On the right hand side, you can have a look on the battery requirement, which is going to be around 600 to 700 volts. Battery controllers, fuel cell will be powered through DC-DC converter to couple on the DC microgrid, which is around 400 to 800 volts. Then we have additional DC-DC converter, which needed to be used for luxurious need, which is around 25 kilowatt DC. Then on the right-hand side, we have the propulsion network from the DC microgrids or a common point of coupling. We are connecting an inverter to drive the motor. Then we are having a controlling unit for all the motor applications. Apart from that, still we have 20 kilowatt AC power requirement for the electric vehicle in transportation, which will be given by an inverter. So you can have a look how the power is enhanced much by the application of power electronics engineers. So in this case, we propose many configuration. These are our own indigenous products, what we develop on these applications. For example, this is a conventional architecture where we have a PV power controlled by a DC-DC converter to connect to a common point of coupling. And windmill is connected to AC to DC because the turbine is a synchronous or asynchronous AC machine. So the AC power needed to be converted to DC. Then to create a balance for the requirement of the common point of coupling, we are using DC-DC converter. Then we have a battery which is connected through a buck boost converter for bidirectional operation. We can pump the power to the battery or get the power to the battery back to the microgrid. Then the application is electric vehicle charging or any propulsion network with the motors or conventional AC grids, we can able to pump the power. So you can see here, we required four converters. We try to optimize with one converter. But for the conversion of a windmill, we need AC to DC because it's a DC converter. It's called a multi-port converter. We can have multiple inputs and the output can be coupled to a common point of coupling. The application is the same. So in this case, we try to figure out with our students a new model along with the postdoctoral students here. Is a new converter. We call it as a three-port converter. We have one port devoted for the output side application for the electric vehicles. Port two is devoted for the batteries, and port one is given for the photovoltaic panels. If you look at very closely the how we frame this configuration, the novel configuration, it's a standard boost converter in industrial application, and this is a standard buck converter on application, the standard boost converter. By including additional two devices and diode for the flow of current, we merged all the power source into a single converter unit. Why we need it? Because the power generation from the PV or photovoltaic or from windmill or from the photo batteries or depends on the capacity. So sunlight is available in the morning and windmill depends on the wind period. So we need to keep always the power consistency to the load requirement. That is called maximum power point tracking. If there is the curve is moving either on the right side or the left side, still by controlling these MOSFETs and IGBTs, we are trying to keep always the power at the maximum power point. So the load will be in continuous propagations. So these are some of the experimental results we tried in the laboratory scale with the low power for the safety reasons. In this case, we tried to get the power from the PV panel is like 12.5 volts, current 7.9 amperes, and the output voltage is 24 volt. You can see the variation is just double to the load requirement, like a battery module for an EV. So EV standard is 48 volts. We tried to get a 24 volt operation to test the system at only 60% utilization factor. And the load current is 3.6 ampere. Why we call it as a 60% means we use only 60% of the power from the PV panel. And these are the parameters of the gating signals given to the MOSFET or IGBT. And these are the currents which are driven to the on the inductor is very important because these currents should be periodic, smooth, and there should be no spikes because it can affect all these renewable. They are very sensitive with the small fluctuation in the current. And the same testing has been carried out at 40% utilization factor, where the PV power we drawn 30 volt, current 800 milliamperes. The load is reduced now, 18 volt, just an opposite operation to the previous case. And the load current, which is around 980 milliampere. Also in this case, we are looking very carefully with the currents because these will decide the reliability and the durability of all the renewables, particularly the battery and PV. So these currents should follow the standards of IEEE 519, less than 5%. In our case, we always target a 1% less. How we are doing all these experimental tests in the laboratorial model? Once we design the converter, first we test in the numerical models with the ideal conditions. Most of the cases we test with a real-time scenario in also in numerical models. In this case, if you look at the efficiency, we try to utilize from 20% to 80%. The efficiency goes to near to 97%. In real time, we have switching losses, conduction losses, passive effects from the components of the electrical network, EMI, electromagnetic interference, so the efficiency goes down to 93.6%. And how we are handling all these with the advanced digital processes? So we have a proposed converters. The converter senses all the parameters of the PV, current, voltage, battery current, battery voltage, output current. And we developed a control algorithm which governs the duty ratio to turn on, turn off the MOSFETs, mode of operation, battery management, and power flow. What is inside this algorithm? It's a simple basics of electric circuit theory. We start the program. We check the power, whether it is greater than zero. Then go to the next step. Check the power is greater than the maximum output power. Yes. Then we are checking the battery current, which is greater than the battery maximum current. Then we connect PV to load. If the fails in the first step, we connect battery to the load because PV is not sufficient enough to drive the load. Or the second condition, if it fails, we connect PV plus battery to the load because PV is not sufficient, but it has a power, but remaining power will be balanced by the battery. Third case, if the battery current is not greater than the battery current maximum, then we check for the state of the charge. State of the charge is 90%, no problem. We can connect PV to the load. If fails, we connect PV first to the battery to charge the battery, then to the load. This is a new configuration. We got a US patent last month, August 26th. So this configuration is a standard model. This is an industrial boost converter on the load side. On the input side, the basics you can see in any power electronics circuits of any power electronics basic textbooks. This is a half bridge inverter. In the half bridge inverter, we replaced one of the device, MOSFET or IGBT, by the inductor. And we include additional one leg where one MOSFET, an inductor, parallel operation with a diode and for a capacitor and a diode for current control. So what is the operation? When the device, yes, is closed, we generate instantaneous energy across the inductor. So inductor is not a storing device. It's an instantaneous energy when there is a power. Similarly, when the device is closed, there will be instantaneous power available in the inductor. When the device is open, the instantaneous energy available in the inductor will be delivered to the capacitor. So we store the energy. And the stored energy will be delivered to the load side boost converter, and we get very large voltage. According to the load requirement, power rating, you can increase the legs from 1 to n according to the applications. So for the laboratorial application, we always test at low power for the safety reasons, insulation and protection. So in this case, we tested between 100 watts to 500 watts, low power. And numerical model, we got the efficiency near to 97%, but in the experimentation, we got 93.2% efficiency because there are switching losses, conduction losses, and EMI. Apart from that, These components are high power application components, but we are testing at low power in the laboratory. Obviously, the efficiency will come down. If we increase the power rating near to the rated condition, obviously, the power goes near to 97% to 98%. What are the applications? So we targeted on getting 400 to 800 volt is the standard for DC microgrids. On the right-hand side, we have a windmill. The windmill power has to be converted into multi-stage because it's going to be a AC. Then we need to convert to DC, DC to AC, then AC to DC to couple 400 or 800 volts. Existing AC transmission lines needed to be controlled by AC voltage regulator, which is nothing but anti-parallel connected thyristors. Conventional thyristors are most reliable device in the world, still now. But they are not applicable for high switching frequency. That is a big drawback. But the current carrying capability is the best option among the best semiconductor devices. And we are connecting to AC to DC to couple 400 or 800 volts. Then the battery is essential because we store the excessive energy when the power generation is peak. We store everything in the battery bank through AC-DC converter. When the load requirement is peak, then we pump the power from the battery. On another side, we have applications. So we have a DC charging station for the electric vehicles through DC-DC converter. We can charge the batteries. In the future, as I said, the each electric vehicle will pump the power from the batteries to the grid so that all the electric vehicle owner will gain the margin from the grid operator. Apart from that, we can able to have a photovoltaic panel which is connected to the DC-DC converters to pump the power to the DC microgrid. Other home applications, because most of our laptops, iPhones, of course, televisions, camera, these are using not AC power. They use DC power. But we use a converter, we never know. We connect directly to a single phase AC grid and we connect to the laptop. But the intermediate stage is a DC-DC converter.